Hello, my name is Arnaud Delorme, and I'm the main software architect of the EEGLAB software. This is part three of EEG processing, where we're going to talk about rereferencing and downsampling the data. So we've already imported data, imported events and channel locations, and now it's time to rereference and downsample the data. You can invert some of these steps. I actually usually re-reference after almost every single step. High pass filtering, I re-reference. Removing channel, I re-reference. So the order is not critical. But so how do you re-reference the data? So we have the menu tools, re-reference. And when you select this menu, you have this interface where you can select the channel you want to reference to. So for instance, here we have re-reference data to channel. So you would check that checkbox and then select specific channels. For instance, we might want to reference to right mastoid and left mastoid. So link, what's called link mastoid. So if that's the case, we would select the two mastoid channels here and then press OK. So when we press OK, we would get an interface that tells us, okay, this is a new data set. What do you want to do with this new data set? And we can overwrite the parent data set when you don't have much memory. That's a good option. At this time, it's also a good idea to save the data set. So we could save it as a file. So if we check that checkbox, it would allow us to enter a file name. And then press OK. And when we do that, we have a second data set. So if we didn't select overwrite in memory, we'll have two data sets. And the data sets can be selected in this menu, data sets. So the first data set is the data set before referencing. The second data set is the data set after referencing. And we can see here the reference is unknown. After referencing, the reference is right mastoid and left mastoid. And you can select the data set here in the data set menu, so you can switch between data sets. Another type of reference is called average reference. So let's go back to this menu tools, re-reference, and now we can select compute average reference. And when we compute average reference, we might, for instance, decide to exclude some channels, like, for instance, EMG muscle or ocular channel, because ocular channel often have a different reference, their reference with respect to each other. So we can exclude these channels from the average reference computation here by entering them in this checkbox. So what's the underlying assumption in average reference? In average reference, the assumption is that the sum of current over all the scalp is zero. So that means that if we were to sum the channels over the whole scalp, the sum should be zero. That would mean, for instance, that we should have channel in the neck, ideally, so we can have a whole enclosed area, and then we're sure that the sum of current is zero. But even if we don't have the neck is actually a good insulator, so a lot of the current would flow to the side. So if we have a good coverage of the head, the average reference assumption is a good assumption. So here, in theory, positive and negative currents across the entire head should balance. No net current or source or sink. Average reference enforces this. In practice, it depends on electrode distribution. For instance, if you have more density of electrodes on some parts of the scalp, the average reference might not be totally true. And the math behind the average reference is relatively simple. So when you collect your data in most amplifier, you don't get just the potential at one electrode. You get the differential potential between one electrode and the reference. For instance, it can be one mastoid here, TP10. So at FPZ, for instance, you get FPZ minus TP10. At FP1, you get FP1 minus TP10, etc. So that's what comes out of the amplifier. The average reference assumption is the sum of all the channel potential is zero. So how do we convert this system to an average reference system? So first, the first step is to recalculate the activity at reference TP10. And to do that, first we'll consider the sum of the electrode of all the activities. So if we take the sum of the electrode of all the activity of all the electrodes, that will be FPD minus TP10 plus FP1 minus TP10 plus AF3 minus TP10 plus F8 minus TP10. So eventually it's all the electrodes minus 64 TP10. And if we do this little trick where we add one more TP10 and we subtract one more TP10, you see this is the average reference assumption. So we set this equal to zero. Under the average reference assumption, the sum of all the electrodes is zero. So now we can easily calculate TP10. So the activity, the TP10 in the average reference assumption is the minus the sum of the electrodes divided by the number of channels. Now that we have TP10 for calculating the potential of each channel, we can just simply add TP10 back to the activity of every single channel. And now we have the activity of all the channels in the average reference. When we go back to this menu, there's a couple of other options. First, there's interpolate remove channels. So if you remove channels, bad channels, for instance, we might want to interpolate them to have a better coverage of the scalp. So the average reference assumption is more true, it's truer. There's also this this options to add current reference channel back to the data. So you saw in the previous screen, we're calculating TP10. Before calculating average reference, this channel is zero. It's TP10 reference to TP10. So TP10 minus TP10 is just zero. But after calculating average reference, then we can recover the activity of this channel. It's equal to sum of all minus sum of the electrodes divided by 65. So that's what's written here, where you can add the current channel back to the back to the data. And in general, you should do that. You should do that when your reference is a scalp channel. If it's not a scalp channel, you don't want to do that. For instance, if your reference is the linked ears, or if it's the nose, you don't want to consider this channel as when you compute average reference. And the equations are almost the same. In one case, we sum all of the channels, including the reference. In the other case, we sum all of the channels and we don't include the reference. And you can replace in the previous equation. It's very simple. The only difference is that in these equations, you don't have to add TP10 back. Okay, so the next step is to resample the data if desired. And the main reason to resample the data is to reduce space on disk and time. For instance, your amplifier might collect data at 2 kilohertz, and you don't need that type of time resolution when you do your processing. So you might want to decrease the sampling rate. So you would go to Tools and change sampling rate. And now you can select the new sampling rate. For instance, 256. Also, what's important to know, and we'll see that in the next lecture about filtering the data, when you apply and when you change the sampling rate, EEGLAB will automatically filter your data at half the sampling rate. So for instance, if you resample the data at 256, it's going to low pass the data at 128 hertz. I'm going to illustrate this in EEGLAB. Starting EEGLAB, Again, I'm going to load this dataset in the sample data folder of EEGLAB. So that's the EEGLAB folder. And I'm going to select this one, which is the dataset that was saved just after importing. And first, I'm going to compute average reference. So I select the menu tool, Rereference, compute average reference. The original reference for this dataset was mastoid, TP-right mastoid, TP10. But the left mastoid was not recorded, so we don't want to add it back to the data, otherwise it would be imbalanced between both sides. So we're just going to compute average reference and not add the current reference back to the data. Referencing data. This is the time where you could save it. You could save your data as a file. Here I'm just going to overwrite it in memory. And then I'm going to resample the data. So that's menu tools, change sampling rate. And I already have 128 hertz here, which is relatively low. The reason is we don't want this data set to be too large when people download it. So I wouldn't want in practice to then downsample to a lower sampling rate, but just for the sake of illustration here, I'm going to resample to 64 hertz. And again, this is going to apply a low pass filter below 32 hertz before changing the sampling rate. And again, what do I want to do with the dataset? So I can just override it. So in the next presentation, we will see how to filter data.